Okay, so the only thing that I'm doing today is just to review the homework on the board. And there are two things that I want you to just to recall, let's say that. If you have elements, the representative particles are the atoms. If you have compounds, depending on the type of compound that you have, the representative particles are going to be molecules, or the representative particles are going to be formula units. But just think about that. Let's say that you have carbon dioxide. You know that the representative particles for carbon dioxide, since it is a covalent compound, the representative particles are going to be the molecules. Molecules, because covalent compounds, they form molecules. But let's say that instead of wanting to know about the number of representative particles that I have in a certain given amount of moles, I want to find how many atoms of a particular element, okay? You're gonna follow the same procedure. The only problem here is that when you go from moles or you go from grams to representative particles, then you have to analyze the chemical formula. Because in one molecule of carbon dioxide, you have one atom of carbon, and then you have two atoms of oxygen. That's the case of covalent compound. But let's say that you have sodium sulfate. This is an ionic compound, and you know that the representative particles are the formula unit. Formula unit. Why formula unit? Because remember, ionic compounds, they don't form molecules. They are made of ions. So sodium is an ion, and the sulfate is a polyatomic ion, okay? So let's say that you want to find the amount of sodium ions that you have in a given amount of this compound. And once that you find the amount of formula unit that you have in the given amount, then you have to analyze how many sodium ions do you have here, and it's given over here by the subscript that you have in here. On the other hand, remember that this is an ionic compound made of a polyatomic ion. If you want to find the amount of sulfate ions that are involved, the whole thing is representing the polyatomic ion. And for every formula unit, you have only one sulfate ion in there. Knowing that, we are gonna check the homework. And you have your first question over here, okay? Basically, it's the same, and you already know how to work with this, okay? So you have ethanol, and look at the formula. That's the formula for ethanol. So just by looking at the formula, you know that ethanol is a covalent compound. And what are the representative particles for covalent compounds? Molecules. But I'm not looking for molecules. I want to know how many carbon atoms I have on that sample. Okay, so after you identify your compound, you're gonna find the molar mass. Because see, if you have grams involved, always you will need the molar mass as a conversion factor. If that's what I was looking over here, finding the molar mass of ethanol. You have that over here. So in one mole of ethanol, 46.069 grams. Conversion factor. So in one mole of ethanol, I have the molar mass. But in one mole of ethanol, I have Avogadro's number of representative particles that in this case, they are molecules. But in one molecule of ethanol, look at the subscript that I have over here. I have two atoms of carbon. From that point, everything is easy. Why easy? Because one, that you have all the conversion factors, the only thing that is left is to set that up. Okay, always you're going to start with what you have. And this is what I have. Beginning, this is what I have. If you don't want to get confused, just put that over one so you can make or you can analyze the union measurements, okay? And that way set up the conversion factor properly. You start with grams, you need the grams in the denominator, okay? One mole, I want to get rid of this. From Most representative particles, you have to set that up and need to get rid of the most representative particles, the one that you have the molecules. Remember that you are looking for atoms, atoms of carbon. So once that you end up with the molecules, in one molecule of ethanol, you have only two atoms of carbon. How are you gonna solve all of that? You already know that. You're gonna multiply numerator by numerator, and you're gonna divide that by the multiplication of the denominator. And I have that over here. When you multiply 45.6 times one is the same number, but times 6.02 and times two, this is the number that you get. Don't forget about the power of 10, and then you're gonna divide that by the molar mass. This is my result, my answer before the final answer. Okay, and then you write the final answer using scientific notation, because remember that you have to express the final answer using the correct number of significant figures. Okay. Over here, the same story, I'm not gonna like spend my time because it's the same compound, and now they are looking for hydrogen atoms. So my molar mass, my conversion factor, setting that up, and I'm gonna follow the same strategy. The only step over here that is new is the last one. Why the last one? Because on the last one, once that you end up with molecules, you know that in one molecule of ethanol, how many atoms of hydrogen you have? You have six over there. And remember that when you are talking about ionic compounds, in ionic compounds, you're gonna have ions, the positive one, and the negative one. You're not gonna find atoms. You're gonna find ions, because one is positive and the other one is negative. And you follow the same steps. For this one, since you already know the steps, I'm gonna simplify my conversion factor, because I know that in one mole of ethanol, I have this many grams, which is the molar mass, but at the same time, I have Avogadro's number, representative particles. So I'm gonna combine these two. And look at what I did over here. I'm gonna start with whatever I have, and then I'm gonna multiply. But I'm gonna multiply by a combined conversion factor. I have grams, and I know that I need grams in the denominator, so they will cancel. But in this amount of grams, which is the molar mass, I have Avogadro's number of molecules. See how I was skipping one conversion factor in there, because it was not needed. In one mole, I have Avogadro's numbers, representative particles, but at the same time, I have the molar mass in there. So I was combining over here the Avogadro's number and the molar mass, because you're gonna have this many representative particles in one mole, and at the same time, you're gonna have this amount of grams in one mole. Follow the same procedure, numerator times numerator, and divide by whatever you have in your denominator, and you get the answer. Now, what are you gonna do now? You're gonna watch the other video that I have posted together with this video, because in that video, that guy is showing you this, but using an ionic compound. Just keep in mind that we're talking about ionic compounds, then we're talking about ions, no atoms. Ions, molecules, they are made of atoms, but formula units, they are made of ions. Okay, just watch this video, the other video, share your homework, open your document, and just start working.